The release of the next major version of KDE Plasma 6.3 is currently scheduled to happen 9 days from now. The beta version was released to the public already to make sure that, you know, people tried it, found any bugs that were missed by the Plasma QA. And you can in fact help out right now by trying it out, maybe in a virtual box or something. Anyhow, I think this is as good time as any to start talking about all the cool features that are included in this release, if that's fine with you. Since this is my channel, I would like to start off with a few things that I managed to implement being a KDE Plasma developer, as you know. Let's start off with panel cloning. For the joy of many, you can now create a clone of a panel that you have. The new panel will inherit all panel settings, applets, and the settings of the applets within. The workflow is pretty simple. You get into panel settings and then you press clone panel and then you select where to clone it to. That's all. The feature is simple enough that I don't know what else to say here. A strong request from the community was to also implement some kind of panel mirroring, where two different panels on different monitors even can use the same settings and all changes to one of them will also automatically affect the other one as well. Though I do see the appeal in that, and many operating systems do in fact implement such functionality, I have ultimately decided against it. My reasoning is that Plasma panels are so flexible and complex to handle that any mirroring feature would end up being very unstable. As an example, having the same panel on different monitors means that the panel will have different lengths, monitors have different resolutions, which is going to affect how the panel is displayed. Maybe one panel will have enough space for a single row task manager, whereas the other one will require two. I currently don't think it's feasible to have a clean way to implement that. Then there's time zones. This is not as exciting, but it actually took various months of development to correctly implement this, so I'm pretty excited myself that it finally ships. Previously, the time zone picker was just a list of all system time zones that you could scroll through. Not particularly interesting, I would say. I have implemented a new time zone component that uses OpenStreetMap and time zones geodata to, you know, actually display all the time zones on a map. You can select any just by clicking on it, and you can switch between them with ease. And there's even a combo box so that you can still select it manually if you don't find your time zone on a map. Maybe you just forgot where you live. It happens. You can find this new selector in the time zone settings, obviously, but it's actually a reusable component. As an example, the very same UI is used in Digital Clock Applet when you go ahead and select time zones to show in the Digital Applet. Behind the scenes, there's also instructions on how to keep the time zone data updated, and even a script that automatically downloads that data and simplifies it enough to be used in the component. The last step is pretty important, given that the raw data is like gigabytes. I've also spent a lot of time, sponsored by Valve, by the way, through Blue Systems, fixing and triaging bugs. One cool thing I've fixed is that when panels switch between floating and not floating, there is now an animation for any applet that might be open at the same time, switching from floating to attached to the panel. It's a nice touch, I think. Still talking about animations, though this one landed in Plasma 6.4, I've also reworked the panel how to hide settings so that all options now play an animation when you select them, as a static image wasn't very effective in explaining what each option did. In fact, I got confused myself at the meaning of Windows Go Below during that merge request, and I had to be reminded of how it worked. Finally, I added a button in the Widget Explorer, which is the sidebar with all the widgets, which allows you to remove all instances of a specific widget from anywhere. This is pretty nice if you've accidentally drag and dropped some things around and you just want to get rid of all of them. A small feature, but nonetheless a quality of life improvement, I think. It is now time to talk about everything else, but before I do that, let me remind you of the sponsor of this video, which is Nobody. In fact, if any, it's you. All the equipment that I use to record these videos was funded by your donations, and you can sponsor my video work through donations on Patreon, LibraPay, Ko-fi, and other platforms. But I will say that I'm currently launching a new website, currently under construction, called thelibre.news, which will contain all of my videos in article format, plus some interviews, plus some extra content. You can also subscribe over there, and I will also soon talk about the folks that host it and gave me some help setting it up. Cool stuff. Anyway, back to Plasma. I've talked about a new time zone settings page, but another that received a lot of love was the drawing tablet one. There are now three distinct tabs: display, pen, and pad. Display allows you to select which area of the screen you want, well, displayed on your drawing tablet, if it has a screen at all. This comes with a very handy visualization that actually shows the mirroring extremely well, and I was particularly impressed with this page. Pen has a graph for the pen pressure that you can edit, plus buttons to work to set specific actions, for pen buttons, plus calibration. Plus, there's a help button that tells you how the pen pressure graph works. That is, you can actually customize it through a drag and drop, which is nice. And finally, pad shows all the buttons available on the drawing tablet itself and allows you to map those to specific actions. You can also decide to let the application themselves handle the events instead of the system. And if the drawing tablet does not feature any button, this section will not be displayed at all, obviously. Finally, the battery settings will now display the cycle count of your battery, which is, well, useful information to have. And look how pretty this is. The info center will also display all of your GPUs with little indicators to tell you whether they are discrete or integrated. Well, now let's start talking about improvements in the applets themselves. One nice feature of the printer applet is that now you can display all printer jobs directly in the applet without having to open settings. Previously, you could only display the most recent ones, and all jobs have a cancel button too. The notification applet also implemented a new is added during inhibition property under the hood that will make sure that when you receive a notification while you have do not disturb enabled and then you disable it, that notification does not become immediately a pop up. Previously, disabling the do not disturb would mean receiving a bunch of pop-ups at the same time that were previously suppressed, but now you can just see them in the applet. They don't clutter your screen. Finally, all applets on the desktop are now slightly blurry and transparent. I think this is a great look, and it's how things were meant to be, actually. As a bit of a fun fact, I was actually tasked with implementing this, or rather fixing the fact that it didn't work, almost 2 years ago, but I never quite managed to fix it. But luckily, someone else did. I believe it was Marco. The Task Manager applet will also now display a much better playback information and UI on hover. If you have multiple instances of an application, the playback will only be displayed for the instance actually playing the audio, and you will have all the info from whatever you're playing. Now let's switch to window management stuff. Firstly, the HDR is getting better and better on each release, thanks to the great work of Xaver, I think it's pronounced. This time around, he has implemented HDR support for SDR screens, i.e. screens that don't support HDR. Apparently, how this works is that when an HDR content is displayed, the brightness goes to the max and pixel values for everything else is decreased in a way that keeps it constant, so you only have that extra brightness on the content itself. Moving on to tiling, you can now set shortcuts to move windows between tiles. That is, you can enter the tiling manager through meta and T, set up certain amount of tiles around your screen, and then move the window between the adjacent tiles near each other by simply pressing a shortcut. So if you have a very wide monitor where the default half tiling doesn't really make sense, you can have your own tiling setup. Even better, the tiling now remembers everything on a per desktop basis, meaning that you can have different tiling setups on different desktops or even monitors. The zoom effect also got a nice feature. If you zoom really close to the screen, a pixel grid will appear. This might mean nothing to you, but to me, as a developer, it's awesome. It very often happens that I have to find some single pixel misalignment, and having a grid to rely on makes that much, much easier. I just love it. Let's now talk about a few more technical things that I don't have screenshots of. One feature is that on Wayland, you can now start drag and drops from windows that are lower in the stack order and that will not raise the window. This makes drag and drop significantly less annoying to deal with when you have multiple windows open. Another noteworthy feature is that the handling of fractional scaling for window decoration was significantly improved, though I don't know exactly what that means, but since it's a bit too technical for me, but if you use fractional scaling, just be happy. You can also choose to have more accurate colors on your screen, though that comes at the expense of some system performance. Still, for artists, it might be a worthy trade-off. Let's talk Discover, our favorite application to install applications. A pretty significant improvement is that now there's support for Flatpak links. So if you click on Install as a Flatpak button somewhere, Discover will be automatically opened with a page of that application. Yay! Furthermore, when updating Flatpaks, Discover will tell you about all the new permissions that an application might be requesting, allowing you to check that you are okay with giving that application even more power on your system. Safety-wise, applications also now have a verified badge when they are packaged directly from the application developers themselves or by a trusted third party. Color-wise, Breeze Dark has been made a bit darker. I actually prefer Breeze Light myself, but I do hope that you will love this new, more obscure design. And still design-wise, close buttons are now consistent throughout the KDE interface, meaning that notifications lost their custom red icon to this prettier one. And finally, yes, there is a new wallpaper for Plasma 6.3 and it looks like this. I think it's cool. By the way, work is ongoing to make sure that we also deliver ultra-wide versions of each wallpaper on top of the light dark variants and desktop phone ones that we currently implement. So yeah, a lot of wallpapers. Anyhow, I believe that is pretty much everything I had to tell you. Even though this last month I was heavily distracted by some personal life stuff going on, university and everything, it was just lovely to see that even I can get surprised by the raw amount of new features in the new release of Plasma. Like, I thought this was going to be a small release. It's not. How do I stop this? Stop. Ah!